Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. This is the seventh Sunday of the Easter season, so the last Sunday of Easter. Next Sunday is Pentecost Sunday, so that's the third of the three great festivals of the church year. So Christmas and Easter get all the attention, but Pentecost is also a big festival day in the life of the church, and we will be celebrating that next Sunday with Holy Communion. And the color of the day is red, so if you want to, you can wear red. Some congregations, everybody wears red on Pentecost. I make that optional. My husband has, of course, this huge collection of Nebraska shirts. Yeah, no. No, he's a K-State fan, but most of you probably have a lot of red in your wardrobe anyway. So, today we will be celebrating the Ascension of Jesus. So actual Ascension Day is 40 days after Easter, and usually that falls in the middle of the week. So we are going to celebrate it today because it's a really wonderful celebration. So today all of our texts and our hymns have to do with Jesus in his glory as he's ascended back up into heaven. I will ask your prayers today for Pastor Jason Bonnickson. He will be installed this afternoon as the pastor of Peace Lutheran Church in Alma. And Rick and I are going to be hitting the road as soon as we can after church to go participate in his installation service there this afternoon. There's a lot of other announcements in the back of your bulletin, so take a look at those. I wanted to point out a couple. The Bucket List Book Club is preparing to read our second book, and we're going to take the whole summer to do it because it's a longer book and summer's busy. So we're not going to discuss it until in the fall, but if you'd like to participate in that, please sign up on the bulletin board so I can order you a copy of the book. You can get it either a paperback copy or a Kindle version if you prefer that. And it's the Book of God, which it's fantastic. It's the whole story of the Bible, but it's written like a novel. So it reads like fiction. It's actually reworded as fiction, but it's the stories of the Bible. So if you've ever tried to read through the Bible and kind of gotten bogged down somewhere in Leviticus or something, this is an excellent way to get the narrative, the stories of God's promises in the Bible, but it reads like a novel, and it's really well written. So if you'd like to participate in that, please sign up so we can get your free copy of the book, thanks to a grant from Thrivent. I also wanted to point out that our congregation is a member of the LCMC Heartland District, and that's congregations in Nebraska and parts of Kansas and Iowa and that area. And the annual gathering is going to be in Elkhorn at Lutheran Church of the Master on Sunday, June 19th. And the speaker is going to be Kent Hunter, who wrote the book, Who Broke My Church? So a lot of us have read that book. Our council read through it, and he's a pretty interesting speaker. So if you're at all interested in attending, the church will gladly pick up the $20 registration fee. You just need to let me know so that we can get you signed up before the end of this month. Does anybody have any other announcements? Mike does, okay.
Good morning. I have a couple of things. Tonight is Pastor's last class, online class. Everybody pray for her so that she passes that, so she can graduate here in a couple of weeks. And so keep her in your thoughts. Another thing, we had council meeting Monday night, and we go through this every year. Some people want to change the summer hours, some don't. The council kind of decided that who was ever in church today, we'd just do a hand vote and do it that way. What we have done in the past, we start on June, which would be June 6th this year, and it runs through August. So if you change your hours, it's from June 6th through August 29th is what it amounts to. Yes.
I quit calling guess if we want to do something different, I need to
talk with the, yeah, I understand. So you're locked into at 9 o'clock there?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know if everybody could hear what Carla said, but Pauline changed theirs already, and they're going to be at 9. So if we change 9, we'll have to take turns playing the organ. Or any volunteers on that? Pastor? That kind of, I don't know. Who would like to see it change till 9 o'clock? Raise your hands if you would. We have 3 that would like to change it. Who would not like to have it change? Who would like to keep it starting at 10:15? Raise your hands, please. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I got 12 to 3, so I guess we'll keep it at 10:15, and that'll work out with Carla too. Any comments? All righty, we'll keep it as it is then. Thank you.
Please stand as you are able as we confess our sins and receive God's forgiveness. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Blessed are those who call on the strong name of the risen Lord. As we gather in the victorious name of Christ, let us open our hearts to him and confess the ways in which we have failed to follow his will and the ways in which we simply neglected our calling as his disciples. Lord of heaven and earth, of the living and of the dead, we come before you, confessing our sins, asking for your gracious mercy. By our human nature, we are sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By your loving kindness, we implore you to grant us forgiveness and restore us to your salvation, that we might live holy lives here and now and be with you in the final resurrection. Amen. Through the gift of the Holy Spirit, God declares to all who believe and confess their sins that we are forgiven and restored to a right relationship through Jesus Christ. We have been renewed and redeemed by Christ, our Passover Lamb. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let us walk in newness of life, following our Lord Jesus in holy obedience. Amen. Please be seated for our opening hymn, which is All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Thank you.
Christ is risen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who went to the cross for our sake, the love of the Father who put an end to the power of death through the resurrection of Christ, and the promised Holy Spirit who gathers us together, be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Our hymn of praise is Jesus, Son of God, and it's up on the screen.
Of our praise, let there be no higher name.
Let us pray. Almighty God, Jesus ascended to the throne at your right hand. Help us to trust in his never-ending presence, that we may bear witness to your grace until the day when we celebrate with all the saints around your throne. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
First lesson is from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning, until the day when he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, whom has taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsibly Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. For the Lord, the Most High, is awesome, a great king over all the earth. He subdued peoples under us and nations under our feet.
He chose our heritage for us,
the pride of Jacob, whom he loves. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
Sing praises to God.
Sing praises to the
King. Sing praises to our King.
Sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a psalm.
God is King over the nations.
God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the peoples gather as the people of the God of Abraham, for the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. The second lesson is from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love towards all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand and join me in the gospel acclamation. One does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God. Your words, O Lord, are spirit and life. The Holy Gospel according to Luke, not Acts.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. So we celebrate Ascension Day today, and my sermon is famous last words. Sometimes I think I'm going to do a whole sermon series using country music songs as the theme of all the sermons. So often I'll listen to a country song and I'll think, there is a sermon in that. Sometimes for the good and sometimes for the not so good. But last week, I happened to be driving along and listening to the radio and I heard a Tim McGraw song from a few years ago. Maybe you know it. The song was "Live Like You Are Dying." Anybody know that song? So it talks about a guy who gets a diagnosis and that brings him up short, and it makes him reevaluate what's really important in life. Hearing that song brought to mind a conversation we had when our kids were still living at home. We had watched some movie, and I can't remember what the movie was now, but it had caused us to talk about whether or not we would want to know ahead of time that we were dying. And you know, one of my kids said, definitely not, they wouldn't want to know. And I said, I think I would want to know because I would want to have the time to spend as much time as possible with the people I care about and to tell them all the things that I'd like to tell them. Maybe I feel that way because I lost both of my parents really unexpectedly, and so it's hard to have regrets about questions you'd like to have asked them or things you'd like to have said to them, things you wish you'd done. So this time of year, we celebrate a lot of milestones, right? Especially graduations. So we have some graduates with us today, right? I was at that graduation ceremony last week, and virtually this week I attended my daughter-in-law's hooding ceremony as she received her master's degree and became a nurse practitioner. So, graduation time, right? Over the years, I've attended many, many graduations. And one thing that I've noticed is graduates receive a lot of advice, don't you? All the cards, all the speeches, all the talks, it's advice, right? Your parents maybe are starting to give you advice. Your teachers give you advice while they have one final chance to, right, to have you listen to them. Everybody suddenly realized that we've run out of time to say all the things we wanted to say and do all the things we wanted to do. So sometimes as parents, we like try to cram it all in, like that vacation that we always wanted to take, or the fishing trip, or whatever it is to spend time together, because we know the clock is ticking and that things are going to be changing in a big way. This is a little bit like what Jesus was doing and what the disciples were experiencing, because Jesus is preparing to leave them for the last time. And he wants to get them ready. He's fulfilled his mission on earth. He's lived a perfect life of love and service, and then completed it by going willingly to the cross to suffer and die in our place, taking the punishment that should rightfully be ours. And he's conquered sin and death forever by rising victoriously from the grave. Now he knows that he's going to his Father in heaven and that there isn't much time left to tell his disciples all he needs them to know. He must give them everything they need to keep carrying on his mission here on earth. So what does he do? He shares with his disciples his last words. And in those words, he offers them three blessings. So if you like to take notes, the three blessings that he offers are God's Word, God's Holy Spirit, and God's great joy. Those three things. So what were Jesus' last words? In Luke, we heard him in our gospel for today. Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised, so stay here in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. Now in Acts, they're recorded like this. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. In Matthew, we know Jesus' last words as the Great Commission. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. So even though different witnesses and writers recorded Jesus' last words in slightly different ways, their meaning is the same. Jesus plainly says that he is the Messiah, that he is the fulfillment of the scriptures, and that his purpose for coming to live on earth in human form was to suffer and die for the sins of all, and to rise again from the dead to defeat evil, death, and Satan forever. The other last words of Jesus, then, have to do with the disciples' mission, which is to share this story, to go and make disciples. This is the beginning of the church, the body of Christ. Why do you think we call the church a body? We're not talking about a committee, a congress, or an organization of some kind. We're talking about the actual body of Christ. After he went up into heaven, his plan for the salvation of the earth and its people was dependent on us, that we, his church, would be his body, his hands to serve others, his feet to bring the good news of salvation, his mouth to speak words of comfort and hope. So that was the mission. And if we remember the disciples' track record, we might think it was mission impossible for them and for us, right? Throughout the stories recorded in the Gospels, they have failed over and over to understand Jesus' preaching and parables. They have argued about which one of them was the greatest. They have denied him, doubted him, and run away in fear, abandoning him in his time of greatest need. How can this bunch now be trusted with this great commission? Well, they can be trusted with it not because they're special or smart or brave, but only because Jesus gives them what they need. So the first gift he gives them is that he opens their minds to understand the Holy Scriptures. This is first recorded on Easter Sunday, on the very day that Jesus rose, when he meets two disciples who are walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus. So all these things have happened. The disciples are hiding in fear and despair, and these two are walking home to Emmaus. And they meet Jesus on the road. And we read in the scriptures that, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. Then on that same day still on Easter, Jesus appears to the group of disciples who are gathered together in Jerusalem, and once again we're told that he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And then in the beginning of Acts, we read again that Jesus appeared to them over this 40-day time period between Easter and his ascension and spoke about the kingdom of God. Can you imagine what it must have been like for those fortunate ones to have this time with Jesus, learning from him and talking to him? The disciples studied the scriptures with their author, God himself. They learned how God's plan of salvation had unfolded all the way from the first sin in the Garden of Eden to this very day. They were given insight into how all the prophets wrote about the promised Messiah and how all their prophecies were fulfilled in Jesus. When you read the Gospels and the epistles of the New Testament, you see that they are brimming with quotes and references to the Old Testament scriptures. And we don't need to ask ourselves how these writers knew these things, because we're told that they learned them at the feet of Jesus himself. The second blessing that Jesus gave before his ascension was the gift of the Holy Spirit. We don't really read about that till Pentecost, which we'll celebrate next week, but we see it being foreshadowed. He said, "When I leave you, I will give you this great blessing, this comforter, the Holy Spirit, to give you power." And, you know, as we read, you know, the last few weeks, we've been looking through the book of Acts about what happened after that, right? It changed everything. It was, as Jesus said, the power from on high. Jesus taught the disciples and he opened their minds, but it was the Holy Spirit who opened their mouths, who gave them the courage and the authority to speak out boldly in his name. The third blessing was a product of the other two. It was the gift of great joy. Luke tells us that after Jesus' ascension, the disciples worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continually in the temple blessing God. Sadness, fear, anger, striving for glory, all these things had been wiped away by the wondrous miracle of Jesus' resurrection. It reminds me of a story about three prospectors who found a rich vein of gold in California during the gold rush days. So these three realized what a great discovery they had, and they decided, we've got a really good thing going here as long as nobody else finds out about it. So they each took a vow among the three of them not to tell anyone else anything about it. So then they headed to town to file their claims and get the equipment that they needed to mine the gold. And true to their vows, not one of them said a word to anybody that they'd found anything. They filed their claim, they bought their equipment, and they headed back out to their mine. But as they went, a crowd of people started following them. Why? They hadn't said anything, but it was because the expression on their faces gave them away. Their faces were aglow in anticipation of the great wealth that would soon be theirs. People knew that they must have found something very spectacular. So a crowd followed them out from town, all because these guys could not hide their joy. That is the kind of light, the kind of fire that must have been on the disciples' faces as they returned to Jerusalem after Jesus' ascension and as they continually praised God in the temple. What a change from these fearful, doubting disciples we've seen up until now. And we know that the disciples did fulfill their mission, using the blessings they had received to spread the good news of Jesus far and wide. How do we know? Because we're sitting here this morning. The mission that Jesus gave to his disciples is now our mission. And the same blessings he gave to them are given to us to help us in the work. We have God's word to guide us, the understanding of the scriptures that was revealed to the apostles and handed down to us. We have the Holy Spirit who comes to us first in our baptism and guides and strengthens us each day. And we have the opportunity to worship God in joy and hope, just as the disciples did. We know the rest of the story. We know that the happy ending does take place, that Jesus has saved us, forgiven us, and loved us in spite of all our faults and failings. We know that the punishment we so richly deserve will not be ours. The joy we feel about that should be shining out for everybody to see, just like those miners. It's the kind of light that must have been on Peter's face as he preached his first sermon at Pentecost. It's the kind of glow among the first Christians that must have caused more and more people every day to decide to be baptized and follow this new teaching. And it's the kind of fire that our church finds again through the help of the Holy Spirit. And when we do, people will see it, and they will come seeking that light, the light of the world. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you have a purpose and a plan for each one of us and for this congregation as well. Reveal your will for us and help us to do it. Show us the hurts that only we can heal. Give us the words that only we can speak. Make us a beacon of light in this community and let our glow draw the lost and lonely back to you. Fill us with the fire of the first Christians so that we too can bring your good news to a troubled and searching world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Our hymn of the day is Crown Him with Many Crowns, number 855 in the red hymnal. Please stand and join me in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we give our offerings to the work of the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Holy God, you promised to send your Holy Spirit to us when Jesus ascended into heaven so that we would not be left alone. Empower us with your gifts as you first empowered the disciples. Strengthen our faith, give us hope in the resurrection, and accompany us on our way. Lord, in your mercy. O God of refuge, you are our rock and stronghold. We trust that you watch out for us and keep us from harm. Give us the insight to know when we are in danger and the wisdom to act on your spiritual prompting. When life spins out of control, continue to protect and preserve your people, especially those who work in dangerous situations. Lord, in your mercy. Triune God, you call us into the world to share the good news of Jesus' resurrection and ascension. Grant your Spirit to give us the right words we need to say in order to proclaim what you have done for us all through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, you are the source of all goodness and mercy. Grant your healing to those who are suffering and surround them with your presence. Help those who need to know your comfort and wholeness and give them hope that is centered in you. We pray especially for Amy Sue, Mike, Scott, Artis, Deanna, Darlene, David, Tana, Carol Joe, Chuck, Tim, Shannon, Roland, Kyson, Annette, and all others whom we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, loving Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your great and abundant mercy. Through the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. You have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Go with the blessing of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is Living Hope, found up on the screen.
Heart could fail.
Christ is risen.